Thank you. Thank you very, very much. It's great to be here this evening with you all. I love speaking to the young people in this country and on campuses or in conferences. You conservative young people give me great, great hope for the future. And I read an article recently which gives me even more reason to be thrilled to be able to have the opportunity to get to know you all. And I'm going to address that in just a minute, that article. Is there no light up here, is there? Okay, I'll just hold these things up if I need them. First thing I want to say is those of you who are new to the Young Americas Foundation, it is a remarkable organization. I've been associated with it now for too many years to tell you, over 30 years, and I've always, always been pleased. And as I look back, I am thrilled to have been involved in this great effort. It really was an inspired effort, in my opinion, and it said often that so many people spend a lifetime wondering if they've made a difference. And those who work with Young Americas Foundation, they don't have to ever worry about that, because an enormous difference has been made because of the effort to reach young people with the message of our beliefs and our values, which they are not getting on their campuses. And with that, I want to address this. I read recently this article. I don't know if anyone else saw it. It's by David Brooks. I should have known then not to go any further. But it's called A Generation Emerging from the Wreckage. What David Brooks did, who is quite an intellectual, to be honest, liberal intellectual, but he's a very smart fella, and he went to college campuses. He chose a few that he'd be familiar with, of course, Yale and Harvard, Davidson, Chicago, and he met with undergraduates and graduates. And he came away with what he is alarmed about, but he doesn't give he doesn't address the real issue. He just observes that these sentiments exist on these college campuses, and oh my gosh. Let me read. He says it's a generation with diminished expectations. They've lived experiences which include the Iraq War. How old were these guys during the Iraq War? Grade school? Must have had an enormous impact on them. The financial crisis, they're about 12 during that. Police brutality and Donald Trump. A series of moments when big institutions failed the basic security and of needs of the country and competence and accountability. We're the school shooting generation, said one Harvard student. I come to think of us, the school shooting generation. My generation is Vietnam. We lost 55,000. We left over there. They didn't come back. Many others came back with never really healing completely. And they're the school shooting generation. How about the Depression? How about World War II generation? Those incredible brave men and women who did everything they could to keep fight for the freedom of others. Goes on that this group of people, they cannot name an institution that works. Family? Church? They cannot name an institution that works because they're so upset by what they've observed. Politicians are corrupt. Intellectuals, they say, are corrupt. They had great faith in the tech industry until, and I quote, the Occupy strategy became a visible failure. This is what these people are concerned about. Let me just give you a few more. We don't even have a common truth. This is Harvard, Yale students. They do not know a common truth which they can pull themselves together and agree on. A loss of faith in the American idea. What David said is, what do you think about America? What we're about? And he said, when I went to high school in American history, we learned about George Washington, Abe Lincoln. We learned about the Roosevelts. We learned about some great people. And we're all very proud. And we're all very grateful to have that in our heritage, in our history. And their response was, in my high school experience, said one, the American Revolution was a rounding error. Others said they were not taught much of it. One said the American story is mostly a story of oppression and guilt. You come to realize the U.S. is this incredibly imperfect place. I don't have a sense of being proud to be an American. The U.S. doesn't have a unified culture as other places do. As I read that, I thought there should be a class action lawsuit against the left intellectuals, for they have so failed, so abused their young people, both intellectually and emotionally, that they did not give them any foundation whatsoever. They did not teach them love of country, love of God, love of family. They did not teach them anything that which they can hold upon, which they have an anchor as things go on, as life gets tough, something to know. Those common truths that are there, no matter whether they wish to believe them or not, they are truths that are there to be embraced, that will give you great guidance in life and comfort during difficult times. They have none of this. It's tragic, actually. It is tragic. I think of my father. When I was young, in that house full of kids, we had seven brothers I have, and a sister. And we sat around that dinner table from the time I was this big. I still remember it as clear, day in, day out. My father taught about my uncles, four or five of them, I guess it was five, all five went over to World War II, fought in World War II. The youngest was only 16. He wasn't staying home. He had to lie about his daggone age to sneak in so he could go fight. He can go fight the Nazis, okay? This is a family he was so proud of, and it was my mother's family. And he was so proud that these individuals, these men he knew, had fought so bravely for this country, one coming back with a Silver Star. He talked about my brothers. Always talk about my brothers, five of them are older than I am. I thought they were the greatest athletes alive. He used to tell them how they caught this touchdown. You just won't believe this game. We taught them, and you'd hear it again and again about the great touchdown. And one of them kicked the ball, the field goal. That was it. It was the biggest win of the, it was Cub Scouts, for God's sakes. I didn't know. I just heard great stories about my brothers, and so I just thought they were the greatest. And he also taught that, I think one of us, I don't know which one, must have taken something bad that happened in the family, which does happen from time to time. We had more than our share. And took it to the outside, told a neighbor, told a friend, told somebody at school, and it got back to Dad. And he said, in one table, we sat down, and he said, okay, now I want everybody to pay attention. Nothing that's bad, nothing that happens in this family that is not something positive ever gets told outside this family. Nothing. And that was the end of it. You don't take it outside. We learned what family was all about at that dinner table, about the love for one another, about how there was respect for family, love of this country. We spoke about the great heroes we have in our heritage and about the great blessings that each of us had because we are American. None of this is taught to these kids. They must have no knowledge of it. How could they have missed this great part of our education about who we are? You know, when I spent many, many years with Ronald Reagan, it's my great honor to have been able to do so. And I think back 15 years after he left the White House, 15 years he passed away, and they put his casket in the rotunda at the Capitol, where he lay in state. And there was lines. People waited all night so they could touch that casket and say goodbye to the president. They had such great respect. Americans from all over, all walks of life, all colors, all religions, were there to thank that man. As that casket left and drove through the streets to go wherever and landed in California out here, the streets were lined with thousands of people. They loved that man. He was their leader. How is it that there could be such a great amount of love for this fellow American. And I'll tell you, he took over this country when we were in real trouble, when Americans had last lost some hope, where they couldn't see their way through to a better future, where they worried that their kids would not have even what they have. And he became their president. And you know, when he announced his campaign, it was in the shadow of the Statue of Liberty. And he announced in 1980, and he said his words, "We are all Americans. We are Americans. We share the same dreams, all of us." He united a country. He united us. He showed us what we have in common, this great country and the great potential here, and that we can be great in the world, in the eyes of the world, and here at home once again. But he told them how it had to be done. He said, "The reason we can be great is because you're great. Each and every one of you, you have great potential. You have the ability to imagine things, to create things, to build things like no one else anywhere in the world. It's you I believe in. It's you I love." And he showed them he did. And they were inspired. And even though times were tough, they knew that their leader back in Washington had their back. And he would come to them and say, "I need your help. I can't hire people. I can't build big, I cannot build offices and businesses and hire and invest. That's what you all do. I can't create. That is your job, but I know you can do it." And they felt inspired. And they decided it's time to do what we do, because we're Americans. We take risks for this great nation. We need to build it, make it strong again. Take care of our fellow citizens. Be there for them. That's what being an American is about. We have this in common, he said. So let's work together and turn things around. And that's what he did. It wasn't just the specific policies. Certainly they played a role. But it was the fact that he told them, "This is your job. I trust you. I believe in you." He inspired a nation to hope again, to dream again, and to have a vision, which they fought for. That's what a leader does. And as I read this article by David Brooks, I thought to myself, no other time does this nation needed great leaders as we do today. We need individuals who recognize their responsibility to step forward and be bold and be tall, stand tall, and be willing to speak about the beliefs that they have in their hearts, about the love that they have for this nation, to help people understand that there are common truths, that there are uniting truths, and to share those ideas, ideals, principles, and values with those around them, in spite of the environment, in spite of the condition. This is what I say when I think back to the days of Ronald Reagan. Many of you may think that they were glorious days. They were difficult. They were hard. They were discouraging times. There were things going on in Washington that you thought, will this ever turn around again? Will we have a chance to be able to have those ideas of ours, our principles, imposed again as policy coming out of Washington? Will we? It was difficult. And Ronald Reagan, he took a lot of grief. It was not easy for him. He was the leader of the conservative movement long before he became president. And he was ridiculed, and he was dismissed, and he was laughed at, as many of you, I'm certain, have felt that kind of intimidation because your ideas are considered so crazy by those around you. He had that same experiences. But I learned from him what it was to be a leader. And that's what I want to share with you tonight. Each and every one of you have come here, and I believe it's because you want to make a difference. You want to be someone who can change, can influence others, can inspire others, who can stand up for those things you believe. And I suggest to you that that feeling is a responsibility. It's far more than just that would be fun. Let's try that out for change. It is a responsibility that you have as an American. You have enormous blessings in your life because of that citizenship. But with it comes an obligation to preserve it, to hold it tight, to spread it, to make sure no one takes it away, and to be able to pass it on to the next generation. As Ronald Reagan used to say very clearly, that this freedom of ours, I have the quote here somewhere so I don't, this freedom of ours is never more than one generation away from extinction. We didn't pass it to our children in the bloodstream. It must be fought for, protected, and handed on to them to do the same, or one day we'll spend our sunset years telling our children and our children's children what it was like in the United States when men were free. This is where you're at today. You're young people looking at your future, and we have those freedoms, ones that many people around the world do not. And if they're special to you, as they sure should be, and if you love this country and recognize the greatness of it, then you have to pass this on to the next generation. How do you do that? You have to be a true leader. You have to want to do this. It has to be part of who you are. And I think I have an idea of how you can get there. A lot of people say, well, leaders are born. They are not born. Each and every one of you has the potential to be a great leader. Not necessarily run for office and be in Congress. Half of those guys, if not more, are not even leaders. So don't think in those terms. Think of in terms of being a leader in your families and in your communities, in your work, amongst your friends. This is where it starts. Here's how it's done. First thing is, you have to know what you believe. Not what I believe. Not what your folks believe. Certainly not what your teachers believe. You have to know what you believe. All right? How do you do that? You have to pick an issue. You can't know it all now. You obviously have some feelings that this is who you are, this is which you want to go, this is the direction you think is best for a nation or for your family or for your friends, whatever it be. You pick an issue that you feel comfortable with now. Then you learn it. You learn more about it. You study it. You talk to other people about it. You then talk to other people who disagree with you, and you study what they have to say. What are their points? Whenever I did TV, they would call me, sometimes same day, and say, can you come down and talk about guns today? So I knew where I stood on it. I understood exactly where I stood on the Second Amendment. But I wanted to make certain, did the other side have some new ideas here? Unlikely, but I will check. And I would immediately go to their websites, not NRA. Surely I would check that to see if there's a new story out there or some new facts or figures I could throw into my argument. But I'd go to the other side and see what they're arguing. I don't want to be surprised when I'm on national TV and they make a statement. I go, whoa, that's an interesting point. It's a pretty good, strong statement, too. I need to have my response, all right? And so I have to have thought it through. And I know they have some good points. And so why are my points better? And make that argument. So what you have to do is pick your issue. And I'm going to pick one for you just for argument's sake. I'm going to pick life. It's my favorite one. All right? And you can be pro-choice. It doesn't matter. You can be pro-life. Well, it does matter because you're wrong, okay? But that's another day. So you pick one. Maybe your favorite thing is immigration. That's a good one for get attention on campuses. And if it's not that, it might be war. It might be the war. It may be this new gal who's been appointed to be CIA, first woman. Going to be big debate on the Hill. Where do you stand on that? Whatever it be, pick an issue, okay, that you're ready to start examining. So let's say it's life. All right, read up on life. Read up. See what the stories are. I always like, when I'm on television or when I'm making a debate, you don't want to overload with facts and figures, but you want a few of them, okay? So you have authority. So you get on television and you say first thing, or radio, you send out one of those facts so people know you're somebody who's done your homework. So I'll say how many, I don't know what it is now because I'm not doing life right now, but whatever is it, close to 50 million babies have been killed since Roe v. Wade. Okay, so you throw that out there. Okay, but I need more facts in case somebody brings something up. I need to know the issue. And I need to know it in such a way that I'm more and more convinced that I'm right. But you don't have to be totally convinced. You just have to be in there. This is your issue. Then you go and talk to somebody who disagrees with you. You find somebody who's pro-choice. And you make a point, say to them, listen, can we talk about this issue a little bit? Because I think you're so wrong. How can you possibly support fighting for? And once you make that decision, now you've talked to a few people, your friends at school, when you go to college, you talk to your college roommate, you make a lot of enemies doing this, it's okay. Because you become known as somebody who believes in something and is willing to fight for it. And that's what you want. It's who you are. And then you say to yourself, we need to up the ante here and find a position where I put myself into that is not so easy as 1-on-1 or 4-to-1. And you say to yourself, any chance I get, I'm speaking up. But what I recommend is that you find a little succinct way of making your case. If it's on life, and as I want to repeat, this doesn't have to be life. This can be a lot of issues. What issue is so important to you that you're willing to commit yourself to it? Something that, a cause bigger than you, that you're willing to work for. All right, so now you have it. Example again, life. You wait for that classroom, that conversation with 20, 25 kids around, and somebody comments on the life march or the Supreme Court decision or some closing of Planned Parenthood, and you say, you know, I just want to make a point here. It can be math class, doesn't matter. Do you know every single time an abortion occurs, it's a baby's life is taken. A little baby's life is taken. You better keep it to once. Don't have to repeat it, because by that time there'll be so much on you. And then you just brace yourself. Because people are going to turn, they're going to look at you, they're going to say, what? What kind of sexist statement is that? Who are you to tell women what they can do with their bodies? That should be their own right. Should be between the doctor and the woman. You've heard all these arguments, or you will have soon enough. And you just hold your ground, okay? You're gonna have people looking at you who no longer like you because you made this statement. You have to feel that pressure. You have to feel that you wish you never said it. Okay, you need to be so intimidated that you think, what in the world was I thinking? Because once you experience that, you'll realize that's how people change you. That's how people make you so you don't say anything. They make you feel bad. They make you feel hesitant to ever do it again. And you need to go through that, because once you feel that, you know you're not ready to be a leader yet. If they can quiet you that quickly, how can you ever be a leader? So you plan, okay, that was a little rough, but I'm still standing. When's my next opportunity? And you do it again and again and again until you're ready. You know in your heart, everything about abortion is bad, and no one can convince me otherwise. I feel it, and I feel empowered to have the opportunity to speak for those unborn children. Because you know what? When you're in that math class and you made that statement and you felt intimidated and all you said was as passionately as you could, every time a child's life's taken, or this is a terrible thing for the mother as well, there's two victims, whatever succinct statement you make, somebody is going to remember it, maybe several. And they may have never heard anyone make it so clear. Simple. It's a child's life. And 2 years from now, 4 years from now, that may be ringing in their head as they're walking into a clinic. And they just may ask for that sonogram to see for themselves. You can save a life because you were willing to stand up, to take that intimidation, to take the kind of treatment that is subsequent to your making a statement where the people around you don't like. But they aren't going to tell you what to say. You're an American. We have a right to speak. We have a right to make our case. We have a right to challenge others. We have a right to inspire, to uplift, to guide, to direct. That is what we are to do if we're leaders. And you cannot do that if you are quiet, if you are silent. So the key is, you have to learn that speaking out, it may not be easy. It takes courage. I'm the first to admit that. And it takes repetition. You have to do it again and again till you are so ready. Do you know how many times I've been called a racist? I don't even mind anymore. I answer to it. Yeah. What did you need again? Okay, what do I care? Because I know what I believe. I know what I believe is right for this country. And I'm willing to fight for it. I'm willing to tell you why I think it's right. I'm willing to take your grief and your shock that I would suggest deportation is a good idea. I'm willing to do that because I think it's the best for the country. And if you want to debate me, let's hear it. I want to hear what you have to say. That's when we're making progress, is when they engage. We're making progress when you put a seed in their minds of what's right, of that principle, of that idea. And we know we are right. We are conservatives, our values, our beliefs. You can see the left is empty. It is empty of this, of anything that would make life a better place where you reach out for others and take care of them because you know what is right, because you have such love for others. All of these things come down to family, to God, to country. I am telling you that we have everything as Americans, as individuals who understand the values and principles of this great movement of ours. And now what we need is leaders. We need people who really believe that will stand tall, that will be bold. And I challenge every single one of you, be a leader. This country needs it. You have an obligation. We can lose what we have. Do not think otherwise. George Washington was very clear when he said the sacred fire of liberty is entrusted in the hands of the American people. If you're not willing to fight for it, we will lose. We are relying on you. You're the generation that is going to need to step forward. So I beg every single one of you and pray that you will be the leaders of this great movement as we move forward. Thank you all very, very much. Thank you. Thank you very, very much. Thank you very, very much. I'm delighted to take some questions on this issue or any other issue that you might have.
Feel free to raise your hand and we will come to you with the microphone. Say your name and school.
Hello, my name is Brandon Malley and I'm from C. Leon King High School in Tampa, Florida. And the family values that you were talking about really stuck out to me and how we need to elect leaders. Well, my question is, how do we elect the right leaders? Because I think we as Americans have been going about this all wrong for the last 20, 30 years. We elect people and they don't do their job. They don't show up. They don't vote on behalf of their constituents, and they spend more than half of their time, especially in the House, they spend more than half of their time campaigning for re-election, and Americans are fed up with it. How do we elect leaders?
The question is an excellent one, and we're all humans, and you know we have a great ability to tell people one thing and then do what, you know, our leaders in Washington want us, because there's too much pressure back there to do what we said we were going to do. A lot of issues that are like that. And I'll tell you what I learned. The establishment is not happy with me on many, many occasions because I primary Republicans. I have gone out into the districts, found people that will run, sometimes unimaginably bad candidates, who had the guts to run against an incumbent, and then I funded them. This is in my wilder days. And the Congress was going wild. We knocked out a few guys. You don't need to do a lot. But if you will do that, if you just get a group, and for two times in a row, this one fell out in Utah. He almost lost to people that were so bad that the third time, somebody good chose to run and whipped them. All right, it became clear that the people were not happy with him, and that the only reason he's saying hang on is because the alternative wasn't all that good. But what it told people is, you know, there's groups out there that can expose us, so we better be a little careful in how we're doing here. If we tell them we're on this side of this issue, we better vote on that side, or we could get taken out. People do not like hypocrisy, and it's a very easy TV ad. Or even radio is what I used to do because it was so much less expensive, to make the case they told you this and they do this. Not hard. But you cannot get discouraged by this. I mean, if you know, we had the Tea Party movement was a fabulous movement. It brought in so many great people, one of whom is going to be Secretary of State quite soon. And it inspired people. Another thing is I've encouraged people to run for president who could not win. And they said to me, I can't win. I said, yeah, I know that. No, you don't think I'm that fool, do you? But they were champions on one issue, just absolute nationally recognized leaders on one issue. And I said, if you don't run, this issue will not come up. They're all going to skate. They're all going to hide from it. They're all going to have some little two-sentence answer, and it's going to say nothing. If you run, you can force the issue. And that's exactly what happened. We forced, 15 other candidates to make the statement and be clear. And they knew if they took a position against my candidate where they stood, where the public was very clearly supportive of his position. And again, we smoked him out. So there's lots of ways of doing it, but you can't get discouraged. We can't have everything we want. And my experience is Americans don't expect to win every time. They expect to be represented. They expect to have somebody there saying and fighting for those things that they love and believe in. And if they don't, that's when real discouragement comes, when the two parties just go quiet on an issue. So you need to have those others around to keep the people knowing that they can make a difference still. It's a very good question, and it's part of politics. It's just part of politics, and it's about growing up and trying to see what you can do. But I have found that you can get a lot of votes in Congress when you take out one of their own, especially with another Republican, which is the only way to do it. Other questions? Yes, sir, right back here.
Good evening. My name's Justin Smith. I'm from Paso Robles High School. And I just wanted to ask, us being young conservatives and following in similar footsteps that you may have followed or people that you've been around have followed, what are some of the hardships that you have faced yourself or seen others face, and how can we overcome those in order to be more successful and not have to rebuild the wheel here, but kind of listen to what you have to say about that.
Excellent question, young man. Excellent. The hardships. Well, one of the really big hardships is what this young man here indicated. You work like crazy for somebody. He becomes the state legislature or congressman or senator, whatever it is, and then he does quite the opposite of what you believed he stood for. That's a complete heartbreaker. You think all that effort. And you can't, you have to recognize these are fellow human beings, and there's a lot of pressure on them, and they make bad calls sometimes, bad decisions. But then you have to get somebody to run against them and say, look, you know, life is tough for you too. We're going to make it that way anyhow. You know, you have to expose them. You have to write the article and make them realize this is too important. This is a promise you made. And as a leader, you have to keep those promises or you have to be removed. And sometimes you might be, you're just a little fellow. What can you do, you know? But you can do stuff. You can do things. But then to stay in it and find someone else. Find candidates you believe in. Do not work for candidates that you think are going to win. All right? If it's together, those two come together, all the better. But you work for someone you believe in, then you can work your head off and know. Several candidates have run that I supported that did not win, my brother being one of them, okay? And do you know how many people are now in Congress or were in Congress because he ran? He inspired others to get involved, to run. And just because you lose, which is very difficult, just because you lose doesn't mean you didn't do good work inspiring others. So you lost, but maybe five others win, and it builds on that. And then my third point is this. The toughest thing I faced, I ran for office myself in California. That's where I am. I never know where I am anymore. Okay, I ran for treasurer of the state here. And I woke up one Sunday morning and picked up the LA Times, and they had a page A3 this big. Treasurer candidate has serious financial issues or something. None of it was true. None of it. And they said I had huge debts and couldn't pay my debts or whatever, some other stuff about I was just financially a wreck. I was a single mom, but I wasn't a financial wreck. And I couldn't believe it. I went to church that day, and I could see people looking over at me, and I thought, well, it's not even true. But what do you do? So I met with the paper, and I presented all of the financial credit unions to show the credit reports of all three of the big guys, and all of them said I had perfect credit. And they said, oh. I said, you never even called me. And they said, well, it was a rumor going around for a while, so they wrote it because they wanted to take me down. They did not care if it was true. They did a retraction way back. So I said to myself, this is terrible. This is just a terrible thing. And this happens to candidates a lot. Okay, so what do? You know what I did? I started running longer and harder because I was so upset. And as I ran, I said to myself, what does my brother do? All the horrible things they've said about him. What does he do? How does he handle it? And I said, he laughs. I said, time to meet to laugh. We can't, as he used to say, we do our best. Let them do their worst. We do our best. If they want to lie about us, then they can. We can't stop that. But we can always do our best. And that is the best lesson I ever learned. Just no matter what they say, no matter what they call you. I mean, being called a racist is not an easy thing. Young people that are running for Congress, they'll tell me, look, I can't take that issue up. They'll call me a racist. And how am I supposed to defend myself in my district? The papers will all say this. And I just say, well, you don't have what it takes, do you? You don't have what it takes. You shouldn't even be running. You have to have the wherewithal, the strength, the conviction of who you are, that you're not going to let anybody make a statement that would cause you not to be that person. And so it's a very difficult lesson. And they will do everything they can to intimidate you. Because if we're quiet, they win. But if we can get out there with our message, we will win because our message resonates. It resonates because it's truth. And it will touch people and change people. And that's what our job is. Others. Yes.
Hello, my name is Thomas Parker. I'm from Piesix High School in Lincoln, Nebraska. My question has to deal with your point in your speech about talking to people and trying to get them to change their opinions on certain issues. So one of the common ways that many people get their news is just turning on the TV. And as of late, media bias and fake news has been more prevalent than ever before. And my question is just, how are we supposed to try to have a decent conversation and try to get people to change their mind when all they hear is just fake statistics and opinions that just have no correlation to arguments and that are just bad for, you know, talking about politics in general?
Excellent point. The first thing, though, I'd like to point out is that we have had fake news forever, since at least for 40 years. And we've had biased news even further back than that. It has gotten more blatant. I guess it was in the Clinton days that they just basically called CNN the Clinton News Network, because they were just Clinton, Clinton, Clinton. It was always plus Clinton, and it still is, okay? You know, even during the entire campaign last time, it was just plus. You couldn't, there was no scandal. Clinton had no scandals. Obama had no scandals. I mean, this is just made up. And I will give Trump credit on that point. He went right after him, and I thought, oh, whoa, this is going to be very, very nasty. These guys have the airwaves. What are you going to? And he just hammered him, and he used a little tweet. And I just think, my gosh, he's a genius. He's gotten around them. And a lot of people say we shouldn't do it. Well, I don't know. I think he took on the news, and I think that's really been an enormous benefit because now Americans recognize more than ever that it's just they shouldn't even have the license to go on the networks because they are not fair and balanced, as is Fox, of course. So how do you do it? I'm not suggesting in any way that you are going to try to change another opinion. What I'm suggesting is that you are going to make known in a very bold and certain way what your opinion is. Nobody likes to have somebody give the sense that you want me to change my opinion. You're wrong, you're wrong, you're wrong. It's like, okay, well, back off because now I'm going to take this position for life because you're so obnoxious. You know what I mean? I mean, nobody wants that kind of pressure. You want to have an engaged dialogue. And that means they can say this and this and this, and you can say, listen, do you know so-and-so? These facts are proven to be wrong that you keep hearing on TV. I just want to make that, I mean, maybe you don't believe me, but here's an article which shows that, and this is in, you know, Business Daily Journal or whatever. You know, I mean, this is objective, and you should be, you know, just to bring it to their attention, if you like, and to make the point. You say, you know, I don't agree with your point here. I think you know, we should never make other people feel like we wouldn't want anyone make us feel. I mean, we should be compassionate. It's not their fault that they're ignorant of the information, all right? It's not their fault necessarily. So how do you tell them in a nice way that you're ignorant? And that's your task, is to say, this is what I believe. I know this. I've met people. I have seen what happens to women who've had abortions. I've talked, let me tell you an anecdote. Let me tell you this. Let me tell you, you said I mean? It makes them doubt their position. It's a life. If you have a sonogram, that's the best way in the world to stop a woman from having a child, having an abortion. Why would that be? Because they see it's life. They see it's life. You see what I mean? And you make these points and you make them passionately. That's the key, is you speak from your heart. And that's what will influence people, not your mind. The facts and figures will not change people's hearts, and that's what we need to do. We have to make people feel about that baby, to feel that, wait a minute, is there something wrong here? Make them uncomfortable with the killing of a child. That is how you change hearts and minds. Ronald Reagan spoke from his heart. The media used to say, oh my gosh, this guy doesn't know anything. He's not only a B actor, he's not that intelligent. Because he would rattle on about some story about this lady down in the street in, you know, Des Moines I met, and he'd tell some little anecdote, and people go, oh, the press would go, whoa. And the American people, when they heard him, when he spoke to them, they were so moved. They said, geez, I know that story. I it sounds so close to what I've experienced. He understands me. He spoke from his heart, and he touched hearts. And once you touch somebody's heart, they will always remember that. So when you speak, even if someone's not engaged, somebody doesn't believe you, if you touch their heart as somebody who is sincere and who believes this with all their heart, they're going to remember that. And there could be one day that things make them start thinking. I went to Bryn Mawr. I had the delightful experience of being sent by this crowd to Bryn Mawr, the Young Americans Foundation. Bryn Mawr is a Seven Sisters school. At the time, it was all women. And it is feminist. It is packed with feminists, okay? And I had 250 girls packed in there, sitting on the floor everywhere. And I'm telling them my title was Failure of Feminism. I thought, how am I going to survive this night? Okay, so I go in there and I'm telling them how the failure that women have been so hurt by feminism and it's failed them, and I'm going on and on, and they're rolling their eyes and laughing and hitting each other on the shoulder, and they're ridiculing me and dismissing me. It was so clear, but I just got that speech finished and I took their questions and I hammered my point time and again, you know? 10 years later, a few years back, I got an email. And this gal wrote and said, "Bae, you don't know me, Miss Buchanan, but you came to Bryn Mawr 10 years ago, and a number of my best friends, with whom I'm still friendly, and we met the other day, and I remember my girlfriends and I, we went back to the dorms, and we laughed half the night at the crazy, ridiculous arguments you made. The statements you made were bizarre. They were completely, and that's what we thought of them. But now the three of us met, and we started talking. And you know what? You were right. That's what she said. You were right in the email. I kept the email. I was like, ooh, maybe I blow it up, put it on my wall. This is amazing, okay? Because I put a seed in their minds. They never heard anybody say it, but I said it passionately. I said like I knew it to be true, and I wasn't going to back away for anybody, okay? And I put that seed, and 10 years later, they started to say she was right. Well, what impact will that have on their lives? Because I put that in their mind. I don't know. But it has to be a positive. And that's what we do. We don't worry about they have all the information, they're totally wrong. You tell them what you believe. And you say so passionately and constantly, you don't back away and you don't start hesitating when they say, well, yeah, well. You don't. You just keep there. Keep solid. Keep certain. Keep tall. Other questions or are we out of time? We do have to go. Okay, good.
Hello, Mrs. Buchanan. It was an honor to hear you speak. So
thank
I
you.
Have two questions. The first question is, going to your position on abortion, what is your position if the mother's life is in danger, if she were to have the abortion, that she would likely die? And then the second question is, after you're done answering, may I shake your hand?
How about a hug and a kiss? on the issue, that's a very, very good question. A lot of people will comment on that. And I got my answer many, many years ago. And I would say I was in my 20s, and I was listening to the TV, and a doctor came on. Her name was Mildred Jefferson. I'll never forget her. She was a black doctor, and she came on, and the reporter asked her. She's very pro-life, and the reporter asked that exact question. Well, what about the woman's life? And she said, you know, as doctors, we have a responsibility to save lives, and that's what we do. We save lives. And if it's Siamese twins, we don't kill one of them. We try to save them both. But in saving one, the other dies. Then we didn't kill them. We tried to save both, but it was not possible. In the case of a woman who's pregnant, and if she continues with the pregnancy, she will die, we tried to save both. But in the process of saving the life of the mother, we save the life of the mother, the child dies. That is not an abortion. That has nothing to do with abortion. And I'll never forget that. She was absolutely correct, but she was also passionate. She knew this. She was a doctor. We are trying to save the mother. And if in so doing a child dies, then the child dies as a consequence of saving the mother. It is not an abortion. It is not considered by anyone who is in this business to be an abortion. So thank you very, very much for that question. We have more, or is that done? One more last question, very good.
Hi, I'm Catherine Brooks. I'm from Trinity Classical Academy in Santa Clarita. I was wondering how you think is the best way for conservative women to combat liberal feminism.
That's a big question. I find this. Be happy. Smile. Let them know you're so happy to be who you are. And they have this sense that we must be miserable because we have all these rules and regulations and we can't do this and our church tells us not to do that and our parents tell us not, I mean, you know what I mean? And that we somehow live this restricted life and we really need to get to be free and that's how we'll find happiness. And so with the feminist, you know, I think you just say to them, you know, I love the idea of being a mother. I can't wait to be a mother. You know, I might have my career first. I might do this first. But, you know, I have all these options. And when I have children, you know, I mean, talk about all the things. What are your dreams? And how being a conservative just is comfortable in that, very comfortable. And don't hesitate. I mean, they think that they have it all. But clearly, they are so they're so contradictory in their own beliefs that, you know, we have this grand feminist who ran for president last year, and she's still trying to figure out why she lost. You know, she's out there blaming everybody. It's the white women. I lost the white women because white men pressure white women to vote against me. It's like, what is she talking about now? I mean, this is the leader of the feminist movement. So we don't need, I mean, I don't see the feminists as anywhere near the challenge to us as they once were. They're not right on the issues. I don't think they're not comfortable. They're not unified. When you look on the issue of life, which is critical to the feminists, that's critical. You cannot be pro-life. And yet the pro-life movement is really made enormous inroads with young people. And in fact, I read at some stage that a majority of young people are pro-life now. Well, this is very disturbing to them. They don't like women, you know, they don't like when men come together, and I mean, what was it called? That was just so shocking to me. It was called the movement. There was a movement of all these men and football players that came together and said, we've got to meet as men, and we're Christians, and we've got to start spending more time with our wives and be more supportive and be there for our kids. And I mean, they would have 20,000, 50,000 men in stadiums committing to their families. And that year, the feminists, National Organization of Women, came out and said it's the greatest threat to women is this movement. And that was in their annual report. The number one threat to women today is this movement of men. And so I had them come on my TV show. I said to my director, my producer, get somebody on right away. This is too good to believe. And I said, they've interviewed the women. The women say it's the greatest thing that happened to their marriage. They're delighted. The men are home on weekends. They told the men, stop spending so much time at the office. Come home. Be there. It's just terrific. And they said, no. They're making the women go and stay in the house and not work and be in the kitchen and have babies. And they said, and I kept saying to them, the women are happy. Is this not a good thing? No, it's not. Okay? So they think they know what's best for us. Just like Hillary, she thinks men are telling women how to vote. Somebody should tell that to my husband. You know, I mean, it's the most absurd thing. It's just not even like worth debating. So my point to you is the feminists are a confused group of human beings. They do not have the right goals, the right sense of what is best. There are truths out there, and they fight those truths. And so it can't work for them. You can't fight truth and then end up happy. That's not how it goes. And we understand as conservative women that we should get all the education possible. That's something we should thrive in, to be educated and informed. And we also know one of the greatest things that could happen to us is to have a family, to be married to a man that loves you and you love. And this is the dream. And there's going to be tough times, sure, but then you have the children, you're there for the children. You put the children first. What a unique idea. You put the children first. Somebody should tell them that. It might work a little better for them. You know, they're so worried that somehow the guy is not going to do half the work. He's only going to do 45%. That's not good. And I say to them, do 100%. That's a good thing. Do 100% of the work. Just make it work. This is not important. You don't have to go into the details to make life work. You do what's best for your family. They are constantly on the other side of all that is right and good. And they're miserable. Because you can't have all these 40-some-year-old women trying to have babies and not think they didn't miss out on something. They did, and they know it. And they might not know it at 20, and they might not know it at 30, but come 40, when they have no family, have no children, and have no husband, they realize something went wrong in their lives, and they were sent a bill of goods, and life isn't good. So be happy. We got the answer, ladies.